Hello, good evening, viewers, and welcome to Animal Talk. And it's Saturday. That's the place to be. I need to apologize for our absence over the last two programs, and we went a little late this evening because of some technical issues. But we're on, and again, welcome to Animal Talk. Tonight we're going to be dealing with some a broad spectrum of issues that is very current and affecting our furry animals and their parents, which I want to highlight this evening. And again, too, you feel free to engage, call any aspect of the One Health perspective that you may want to talk about, discuss. Feel free to do so. We're into December, the last month of the year, into the festive season, and I guess you know what comes along with it. But tonight I want to take some time off to highlight some very troubling issues that keeps hovering and hovering, comes and goes. And I've over the last, I would say, 2 months, the incidents have been increasingly high. At one time, I thought we were getting over the hurdle, but it seems to be a recurring decimal. And tonight, I want to speak of the loss of quite a few of our furry friends from malicious acts of people. In some instances, accidental; some of them, deliberate. And loss of a furry friend is a loss of a furry friend, irrespective of what the circumstance or circumstances that lead to the demise of that furry friend. We've had over the years, it's less prevalent now, but like I said, over the last 2 months, the incidents have spiked, and it's a little troubling to me. Sometimes, under the circumstance, you just cannot put a dial on it, and as to why and what may be the initial cause, because the patient comes in to us at the end point and you try and battle, and nothing much that you can do at that stage. It's been a practice over the years where people who would have used as a means of dealing with issues or their issues, where you have animals caught up in the midst of those issues, issues between neighbors, and they, for some reason, can't get to the person in question. They would target the animals. We've had also where persons trying to get into properties not belonging to them, not being authorized, and if there were furry friends around, that would serve as a deterrent to them accessing certain properties. They would act in a manner to try to eliminate what they perceive to be a deterrent, and by so doing, get rid of some of those furry friends, and which within their own space. We've had a reduction in this, or I'm not sure if it's a reduction in the occurrences, or a reduction in the reporting of the issues, or a reduction in animals being presented with signs and symptoms of suspected poisoning. But like I said, over the last couple of months, we've had a spike in animals presenting at the clinic with signs and symptoms of poisoning. Yeah, and like I said, whether it is accidental or whether it is deliberate, but nevertheless, the incidents keep on climbing. And The persons who may not have had the experience of bonding with a furry friend, bonding with an animal, may not understand that discourse tonight. And those of you who have had the experience of that bond can or will understand what we talk of when somebody lose a furry friend or furry friends in that manner. It's not a case where the animal was sick. It just happened that you notice, when I say sick, of known causes other than suspect poisoning, where your animal is presented, all you would know of is the animal may have certain aspects of the animal may have changed. Its appetite for food or drinking or certain behavioral aspect of it may have changed, and that might cause some alert and respond. Many a times persons do not identify the changes early enough, and by the time they notice it and try to give a response to, it's many a times it's too late. And this is the heart-wrenching one, where the animal come in and you try your best to try and alleviate the condition, try and improve the status, and you can only reach that far because there have been so many damage to the animal systems in that not much can be done. But we try anyhow. And I think it's something that had stopped for a while. And like I said again too, maybe it's very stopped in the sense that we were not seeing, but maybe it was still happening, or it was not being reported, and animals were not being taken in. But my concern is that the over the last 2 months, the amount of cases that we have been seeing, and the majority of them at the stage where they are presented, we've not been successful in pulling them through. We've been able to pull out a few of them, but the great majority we've not been able to. And again, too, and not being presented at the stage where you've had so much of the organ systems being affected, and there's not much can be done to reverse. Some will be successful in doing so. Most of them we've not been able to. And again, too, it's in the case where many of them, or most of them, the suspicion is that it was something deliberate. Owners claim that they have not used any. The most common one would have been the rat baits or slug baits. They have not baited the areas, so they are not aware of any toxins being placed within the vicinity where the animals would have had access to. So most of them would have been in that case where the possibility would have been maybe the animal may have strayed and had access to something toxic outside of its living environs, or somebody maliciously could have introduced something toxic within the space, and which is many times the most common one. Yeah. The chances of the animal surviving those malicious incidents is very slim, especially where we refer to the series of poisons, fast-acting poisons and your slow-acting ones. The animal will show signs almost immediately that the presence or confidence of the animal, and you're observant enough, you may be able to give a quick response and help save this animal life. The slow-acting ones is the most, for me, dangerous ones, in that you would not have known that the animal may have had access to any poison, and you go on your merry way, and not after a few days down the line, then you would start seeing the signs of symptoms that something is wrong. Not eating, maybe trying to take in a lot of water. It gets to a point where it is very listless, difficulty breathing. These are some of the signs that you would notice. Yeah, but many times when, and again too, some family members of the furry friends, the response is they play a wait and see game. They notice something is wrong, but let's wait and see if it gets better. Let's try this and see if it gets better. And the time that you wait to see if it gets better, it is deteriorating at a rate that by the time you seek professional assistance, it's too late because too much damage has been done. Yeah. So we're into the festive season again too. We know when the time you have activities that are not perceived to be conducive to persons in which those activities are being extended to. In the case of assaults and robberies and illegal entry to properties, we know within that time of year there tend to be an escalation as in those activities. Yeah. So again too, I am saying to you out there, be on the alert, on the P's and Q's. I can give you some home remedies that you could use in the event that you suspect your furry friend may have been subjected to some toxic substance. And they are very simple and very cost effective. One of it is milk. Milk is referred to as an amphoteric substance in that it has the ability to act in an acidic environment or an alkalinic environment. And these are the two bases of your poisons. It's either an acidic base or an alkalinic base. Yeah? A positive ion, a negative, positively charged or negatively charged. The milk has that ability to act in either one of those environments. So if, for argument's sake, the animal may have ingested a poison that is alkalinic base, a negative ion, the milk has the ability to counteract and to attract that negative ion and lock it. Yeah, if it is a positive, if it is acidic, it has that same ability as well to attract the ion with the opposite charge and lock it, so it doesn't give it that ability to act on the mucosal surfaces of the animal where the toxin can be absorbed. Yeah, so just remember that. Keep milk at hand. So if you notice that, or you suspect that the animal may have ingested something toxic, something poisonous, yeah, quick response, as much milk as possible, allow the animal to ingest. If it's not able to ingest, you can try and force some down its throat. And like I said again too, the milk has that ability to act in either an alkalinic or an acidic environment, yes? And these are the two fundamental basis of your poisons. So if it is a positively charged ion or it's a negatively charged ion, the milk has the ability to act in either one of those environments. If it is positive, it has the ability to attract the positive ions. If it's negative charges, lock it in. If it is negative, it will do the same. Yes, so the milk will help to neutralize that toxic substance and not allowing the body or not allowing it to be absorbed by the body, where it can cause a lot of damages to the system. That's one. Another one that can be used is charcoal. Yeah, charcoal has the same properties as the milk. Charcoal is a very porous substance. It's heavily charged as well with both the anions and the cations, or the negative and positive ions. And again, on the same basis that the poison could be either one of those. That's the base of it. So the charcoal has that ability, just as the milk, to attract the opposite charge that the poison is of. If it is a negatively charged poison or positively charged one, the charcoal has the ability to attract the charges and to lock it, so it does not allow it to act on the surfaces of the gastrointestinal tract. It could be from the mouth all the way down to the anus. So it has ability that when it gets to and when it's ingesting, so the first part of action would have been most likely the stomach or the esophagus. While it is transiting down to the stomach, it can start acting on those surfaces. Yeah, so that would be your first response, and then after you've done that, you try and source the services of a veterinary professional to assist in trying to alleviate the conditions of the animal. But your quick response can make a difference as to whether this animal is alive within the next half hour, the next couple of days, or it's not. That can make a significant difference. So that would have been your first response at home, and then you can take the animal to your veterinarian and let he or she follow up from there. That is very, very important. And many cases we've had animals coming in, and only if that was being addressed or applied before leaving home, that could have made a significant difference. Yes, but again, too, for the fast-acting poisons, this works very well. And again, like I said, the dangerous one is this slow-acting one, which you may not observe anything until 2 or 3 days or more down the road, when the body has absorbed those are poisons and start affecting the animal organ systems. But it doesn't matter if you observe it or you notice animal may have ingested, try to do so. There's a practice which I do not support, where persons try to give salt to the animal to induce vomiting. You have to be very careful with that. Sometimes the amount of salt that persons give, they do more harm to the animal than anything else. Yes. If sometimes the best thing is, instead of vomiting, like I say again, too, many times you're out at war, so in the battlefield, every soldier plays the role of an MD. Because you want to save the life of your partner who's at the risk of dying, so you try anything to save his life. I can understand that, but I would advocate against using salt. Like I said, the two substances I would highly recommend, if you observe any intake of toxin, I would recommend that you use the milk or charcoal. Another substance that you could use as well, again to on the same basis of its the charge of its cations and anions, or the negative and positive charge, is clay. Clay has that ability. It's heavily charged with those ions, and it can play. It acts the very same way that the milk and the charcoal would act. It has that ability to attract the ions of opposing charge of the poison. So like I said, if the poison is a negative charge, it has the ability to attract that negative charge and lock it. Likewise, if it is a positive, it has the same ability to do so and lock it. Yeah. And in this case, it's not only it would play that role for animals. It has been proven that even with humans, it works as well, because the principles are the same. Yes, in particular, so with gomoxone poisoning, paracort, the only known substance that has been able to serve as a counteracting substance to the paracort, or an antidote, so to speak, is the clay. Yeah, and those of you farmers out there, those of you who still practice using weedicide to control weeds, if you're going to mix a solution of come out zone, the power cord, to spray. And that substance, that water, sorry, is not clean water. If it is very muddy, where you have a lot of clay dissolved in that water, the efficacy of the Comaxone on the grass, it will be almost zero or very poor. For the same reason, the iron content of the water with the dissolved clay in there would attract the charges of the power cord, lock it, so it makes it inactive. So to the point where the spraying of the grass is almost nil, yeah, for that same purpose or same reason, yes. So the same is applied, can be applied not just to the animal but to humans as well. The principles are the same, yeah. So again, so to you out there, keep this in mind. If you don't have any, I know some persons are lactose intolerant, so they don't keep milk at home. But if you have your free friends, try and keep some in the event that you may need to respond to a situation where you have some level of toxicity that you may have observed or have some level of notion that the animal may have been exposed to, or you notice the signs that it is exhibiting could have been this. So that's a very quick way of responding at home, and then you seek the assistance of your veterinarian. Yeah. Again, too, like I'm saying, it's this is something that I can say a loss is a loss, and it's very disturbing when you have to give that news to a client that their furry friend did not pull through, didn't make it, or it's no longer with us. It's for some people, like I said, who have not experienced this, unless you've had the experience, you would not know what it's like to know that your furry friend is no longer going to come back home. It's left and left forever. That's it. End of the story. It's not an easy one. And sometimes, and for us at the clinic, I can tell you, this is the most difficult moment to engage a client, to tell him or her that their furry friend is no longer with us. It didn't pull through. It didn't make it. Yes. It's, for me, the most difficult and challenging moment to engage a client. So I'm saying, for those of you out there, and I guess for me, persons who still go ahead and practicing those malicious acts, it's a sense of cowardness. If you have, like they would say, a beef with somebody, engage them as a man or woman, face to face. Why you have to let the poor animal be the one to pay the price for your cowardness? Yeah, I mean, engage the person one to one, talk to them if you have to. If you have to feel a fist, do so, but don't hide behind the curtain, behind the wall, and try to hurt the person by just trying to destroy or take a life of his or her for your friend. I don't think it's fair. Like I said, to stand up as a man or woman if that's what you are, and engage the person that you want to engage, and don't maliciously try to destroy or take away the life of that joy that he or she may have, as a means of, you can't get to them, but you try and take away something that is very dear to them by taking the life of his or her furry friend. Yeah, you've seen too much of this, like I said. And for me, I know it's hung in there, but over the last couple of months, we've had too many of this. So it, almost as if it's jeune vu. It's something that is just coming back to the fore. And people, we're supposed to be improving. We're supposed to be growing as a people. And some of those practices those habits that we engage in, that's supposed to be something of the past. Yeah. It's a very difficult thing for me to deal with, far less the owners or the family members of those furry friends. So again, I'm asking you to be vigilant. Those of you who may lactose intolerant, don't use milk, or vegetarians don't use milk, and you have furry friends, just keep some in. There's nothing wrong giving to them. But just keep some in the event that you may have to have reason to use it for that purpose. Your charcoal as well. You can get your charcoal tabs at the pharmacies. Those of you may want to use your own homemade. Your call coming in there. Yes. Good evening, caller. Hello, good evening.
Yeah, good evening. What's wrong? Yeah, good evening. Why you not? Why
yeah,
you,
go ahead.
Why the person not bullied? Keep it animal, eat that food.
Sorry, I'm not hearing you clearly. Can you speak a little louder?
I said, why the animal bond you?
Why the person is what?
Rolling the animal in the bond.
Uh-huh.
The animal won't come on the person's property so that the person will have no cause to destroy the animal.
Okay, my brother, whether it is the person's your property or the person's boundary, I need you to understand that if you are caught and the evidence is there, whether it is your boundary or not your boundary, in placing poison for an animal, that's a criminal offense. You can be taken to task.
So why the person don't want to tie the animal? That's what I want to know.
My brother, all I'm saying to you, if there's an issue, you can approach your neighbor, because if you're talking about boundaries, meaning that you've been bordered by a boundary, so it's a boundary separating you and somebody else. Yeah? Engage so the person. There has to be some a different way in addressing this thing instead of putting poison in. And I can say to you, whether it is your boundary or not your boundary, if you are caught in placing poison to an animal, it can be proven, that's a criminal offense.
So there's no law for that.
The law is that don't take it in your own hands. Go to the police, report the matter, and let them take it on. Yes. Don't take it in your own hands and poison the person, animal. That's a criminal offense.
All right. Yeah? All right.
Okay. Yeah. And again, too, people, I mean, like I said, if there is a beef, there's some dispute between you and your neighbor. Yes, good evening, caller. Hello, good evening. Hello. Sorry, I'm not hearing anybody online. Hello, good evening.
Hello.
Yes.
Good night.
Yeah, good night. Go ahead. Make your point. I can hear you.
I don't think to kill my dog there.
Hello? Are you making a point? I asked a question. Go ahead. Hello? Person, I'm an idiot. Yeah, people. Again, there is a process. Yes? It's an animal that you may perceive is trespassing, coming onto your property. There's a process where you can report the matter to the authorities and let them engage the other party to resolve the issue. Don't take it into your own hands because the animal is coming onto your property. You feel you have the right to place poison for the animal. If you are found and it is proven that you, whether it is your property or non-property, or the one who placed the poison to intoxicate and take the life of the animal or animals, you can be taken to task, because this is a criminal offense. Be mindful of that. So whether it is your property or not your property, that doesn't make it right. Yeah? That's what the law is there for. Report the matter to the police and let them engage the other party to resolve the issue. Don't take it on in your own hands and try to think that because Emma is coming to you on your property, you have the right to place poisons. No. And like I say, that's one time your right will turn to your wrong, because if it is proven that you were the one who placed the poison that caused the demise of the animal or animals, it's a criminal offense and you have been taken to task. And I'm saying so because I have known of instances where that has happened, where a farmer had some goats and there were dogs that were molesting and destroying his goats. So he decided to, enough is enough, take it in his own hands and place poisons around his farm. And some dogs were killed, and the owners of the of the dogs took him to task, took him to court, and he paid the price. So all I can tell you is, do not take the law into your hands. If something is wrong, that's what the police is there for. Report the matter and let them take it from there. Yes, good evening, caller.
Yes, good night.
Good night.
Yeah, what is the recommended treatment if a dog actually eats a toad, which is toxic?
Sorry, I didn't get the question. What is the... Hello? Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't get that question. People, take your time, please. I'm hearing somebody's talking, but I'm not hearing what you... Yes, good evening, caller.
Yes, I was asking a question.
Yes, go ahead.
You didn't get a question I asked, I'll just repeat it.
Yeah.
Can I go ahead?
Yeah, go ahead.
Yes, in what is recommended treatment if the dog swallows a toad, which are quite toxic. Yeah.
If it swallow a what?
A toad.
A toad?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. If there is a substance that the toad secretes, I'm sure you have noticed it. When the toad gets agitated, if you're troubling it, you would notice what they refer to a milky substance appears around the head. Yeah? The animal discharges that substance as a means of defending itself, because this is poisonous. So if the animal gets this onto the surface of its tongue, around the mouth area, it's absorbed very quickly through the mucous membrane into the circulation. And if you don't respond to that very quickly, in a very speedy manner, that animal can die. We've had a number of cases that we're able to save by a string of a thread from animals being exposed to toads with that latex. But again, you said it's swallow. And again, too, I would imagine if it's swallow, maybe it's a small toad. But nevertheless, as you have different types of toads that I'm not sure which one that you're referring to. Some of them may be more toxic than others. I would do the very same. Don't take any chances. If you notice it, allow the animal to have some milk, as much milk as is possible. Or if you have some charcoal tabs, you could. In that case, I would recommend between 2 to 3 tabs for every 20-25 pounds body weight. Yes, because you need to have enough in there. You're not sure what amount of poison the animal may have ingested. How toxic is the substance that the animal may have ingested? So you won't have enough in there to counteract that poison, and it's not going to anyway harm the animal if there is more in there. Good evening, caller. Yes, good evening.
But man, what about if it's the animal now that destroy your plant? What penalty? Do you have a penalty for that?
If the animal
destroy your plant?
Yes, the same goes. Like I said too, if the animal destroys your plant, I'm going to come over, and for me that is trespassing. You can take the matter to the police. Report it to the police. That can be done.
All right. Yeah. Yeah? All right.
But don't take it in your own hands and try to say you're going to poison the animal.
Right.
Yeah. Like I say, your right will turn to your wrong.
Okay, I agree with that. That makes sense. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, thanks.
Okay. Yeah. Again, people, the caller was asking if what happens if the animal eat your plant. In the rural areas, at one time you had those rural constable, and I remember growing up, they were the one who would have been the person to come in to mediate, where a farmer would have had his farm or a crop within your yard, and the sheep or goat next door or the cow would come across and probably damage the foliage of that crop or plant, and it would be the rural constable most of the time would be the one coming to mediate to estimate the value of the crop, the cost of the damage or damages, and have the owner of the animals to pay. Yeah, and those things were being resolved in a manner that was very cordial. Right now you have with time those rural constables, they have disappeared, no longer active as I knew them to be. You have the Peter Lasney group, which is an arm of the Ministry of Agriculture. I think now they operate in the, if my memory serves me right, in Mikud and Viewfort. I think that's where the offices are. There was an office in Babano. I'm not too sure if that is still active. There was one in the Mabia Valley at the Equatorial office in Richfort. I'm not sure if that is still active. So those of you farmers who may have similar issues where somebody's animal is trespassing on your farm and destroying your crop, don't take this into your own hands and try to destroy the person animal. Peter Lasney group, like I said, I'm not sure if those offices are still active, but I know at one time they were in the Babano, the Valley, the Richmond office in Viewfort and Mikud. So they can be reached, so they can intervene and try and put in some peace and resolve the situation. Don't take it into your own hands. Yeah. Okay. The other area that I want to bring into your attention, I'm not sure if it is here. I have not seen it. There is a disease that is a respiratory disease that is manifesting right now in North America. And it's causing some serious concerns among the veterinary profession and the owners and families of furry friends. And we know it's just a blink of an eye away, whatever up is in North America, just as COVID was, could be here anytime. And we're now into the tourist season, so that means that persons from North America, Canada, is visiting St. Lucia on a daily basis. And there's a lot that is not known about the disease. It's a respiratory disease, and lots of animals are being affected and dying from the condition. Yeah. It is now being identified as a bacterial infection, and the signs that has been presented, it's just as a respiratory condition, coughing, sneezing. It may develop into a pneumonia, and you can get animals dying from the condition. And it's spreading quite through a number of states in the U.S. And like I said, I have not seen reporting the concern over respiratory conditions being manifesting. So I know many times you may have conditions and persons try to do their own home treatment and only get to the vet when they feel nothing more is working for them. At that time, many times it is too late. So I'm bringing this out in the event that you may have your furry friend manifesting any respiratory conditions, do not linger on it. At the soonest, please take report the matter, so at least something can be done, at least it can be taken note of. And if it is that condition that is circulating, like I said, it's not known how it is being the spread, but it is respiratory in nature. So whether it has the ability to spread on what they call fomites, on objects that is non-living, that is not known yet. So be on the P's and Q's. Like I said, the tourist season has just started and people are moving at a very, the numbers are increasing. The rate of movement is increasing from North America to the Caribbean, to St. Lucia in particular. So be on the P's and Q's. If you're noticing that your furry friend is presenting any respiratory condition, please do not linger. Take the animal in so at least some response can be given and you can take it from there. So I'm just throwing this out there. If you notice it, don't linger, take it in. Yeah. You on the issue of the poisoning. It's something that I was exposed to that case, and I know it is happening, and a lot of it is not being reported. Yeah. Over the last 5 to 10 years, with the increase in certain demographics, certain jurisdictions, where the use of cannabis is legalized, we've had cases where animals have been intoxicated by the use of the intake of cannabis. In different forms, candies, cakes, you name it, yeah. So, the intoxication has happened. I had a case that I had to intervene, and persons were panicking because the animals were in a state of delirium. It's the same way like somebody who is high and restless and not knowing what to do, and sometimes you can have excessive vomiting as well. Yeah. So, and again too, it is as a result of an intoxication, in that the animal may have consumed too much of this. Yes. And again, for the same reason, persons may want to induce vomiting by applying salt. Please don't. I'm repeating it again. I do not subscribe to the use of salt to induce vomiting where you have a suspect case of poisoning or intoxication. I do not subscribe it. I'm advising you to please do not apply it if you suspect such. Yes, allow the animal to, if you can apply, like I said, the milk or the charcoal. These are these are two substances that can act in an environment where you have a poison active, in that the animal has taken in a substance that deemed to be a poison and it's going to start affecting the animal because the body is absorbing that substance. Your charcoal and your milk has the ability to act and intervene, or like I would say, lock that substance, doesn't allow it to act. Yes. So, and again, too, and let's not try and be naive about it. The recreational use of cannabis have increased sky high in St. Lucia, and the use is much more now than it was before. Yes, because it is now available in different forms, so persons that are taking it, the intake has increased because of the availability of the substance in different forms. And the animals, furry friends, within the environment where this intake is being practiced, they're exposed to it, and they too sometimes help themselves, and they can be intoxicated. Yeah. So, in this case, I would go the way of using to be safe. I don't try to use this salt thing to induce vomiting. You're going to make the situation worse, because if the animal is already vomiting and you've taken in that much salt, all you're doing is further dehydrating the animal, and the salt in itself can intoxicate the animal. Yeah, so be very careful with this. Yeah, so on the safe side, I would go the way of the charcoal or the milk, and try not to use salt to induce. You may be lucky enough that in some cases it does, but I won't take a chance, because you don't know which of the two forms of the poison that you have, but it is a acidic or a alkalinic based poison. Okay, all right. Like I said, we're getting into the Christmas season. Another condition that is still surfacing, it's not as apparent as it used to. I would say 2 months, 2.5 months ago, when the rainy season was, for me, more at its peak. We had more rain then than we have now. It's the condition that we refer to as parvo or parvovirosis. We're still getting isolated cases of animals being presented with the condition. So people, please, again, we in December, lots of persons are making presents to other persons in the form of furry friends. Yes? My advice to you, please, those persons who are presenting themselves as breeders and engaging in the breeding and selling of puppies, the responsibility is yours to make sure that that puppy, before he or she is sold, that they receive their first vaccine. If not, you're selling an animal out there and putting the animal life at risk because of the amount of stress levels that he or she is going through, and will not have the ability to be able to put up a defense for themselves. Yeah. So even if the first vaccine, you don't have full immunity either, but at least there is some introduction of the antigen that would stimulate the buildup of the antibodies to defend that animal along the way. At least the process would have started. And again, to those of you who are receiving furry friends as presents for Christmas, if that furry friend coming to you has not been vaccinated, please, it's your responsibility to make sure that you get that furry friend that has been given to you as a present vaccinated. And that is the surest way of preventing the disease. If the animal is manifested, the risk is too high, the stakes are too high in treating this the animal. The last 36 that I came across at one time, the survival rate was 50%. Now it has gone down to about 2%. So you have an animal that has been subjected to the condition, the chances of it surviving is 2%. A litter of animal being affected, the percentage of that litter that you will lose is about 98%. Yes? And the reason for this is the virus is becoming, there are different strains now, and they are becoming very, what you call, pathogenic. They are able to induce disease at a rate that is higher, and the body is not, the animal is not able to give a response to the virus, so they succumb to it. So in other words, the amount of animals that are able to survive has reduced considerably, and the amount of animals that you will lose from the attack has increased considerably. So the rate of mortality is about 90% now in certain jurisdiction. So the survival rate is just 2%. So again, too, in some cases, based on the amount of treatment that would have to be administered, the survival rate can increase, but the intervention would have to be so much higher. So that would mean it's of a much greater cost to you in trying to survive this animal. Where if the animal was being vaccinated as stipulated, your first vaccine within the first 6 to 8 weeks, and then you vaccinate within 3 to 4 weeks, or the regular that we use here, 4 weeks interval. So within 2 months of animal receiving its first vaccine, it should have received its 3 vaccinations, where you expect to have a certain level of coverage to protect that animal. Yeah, and then your annual vaccine 1 year after your third. So again, persons, please, I know up to today I had an animal that was presented as a gift and was taken in for its first vaccine again too, which was not done by the person who bred that animal, which is supposed to be their responsibility. But in the case, it was taken in for its first vaccine. So I'm sure there were a lot of these that has started Christmas. Persons are giving furry friends as gifts for Christmas. So make sure that your furry friend, make sure that your gift, your furry friend, is vaccinated. If it is not, please, it's your responsibility to get he or she vaccinated. Take them to a veterinary clinic to get that done. And by doing so, you can save the life of this animal if for any reason he or she may be exposed to the virus before having their immune system developed in a manner that would protect them from that virus. Yeah? So precaution is better than cure. The stitching time saves 9. Get an animal vaccinated is going to cost you much, much, much less than having to respond to a situation where the animal gets infected and now you have to try and save its life. Okay? The issue of the vaccine, many times persons believe that the just one vaccine is sufficient to protect the animal. It's not. And there is a misconception that the vaccine is going to help the animal develop to put on weight. It will not. The purpose of the vaccine, like I said, in St. Lucia, we vaccinated against 5 major dog diseases, which is parvovirus, distemper, power influenza, leptospirosis, and adenovirus type 2. These are the five diseases that we vaccinate, and that has been done as a combo in that one vaccine has all of these in there. And with the leptospirosis, again, too, you have a number of serovirus, again, to break it down subtypes of the leptospirosis that can affect dogs, that you have in the vaccine. The two major ones would be the canicola and the ectrohemorrhagia serotypes. And again, to, as you know, leptospirosis transmitted by rats. It's a waterborne disease, so not just being able to be transmitted by rats, but if you have water that is contaminated and you expose yourself to that water, or the animal exposes itself to contaminated water, they can pick up the virus, the bacteria, from that source. Yeah. So again, to people, be very mindful of this, and like I said, a stitching time save 9. It will be much more cost effective if you get that animal vaccinated in time. And I was alluding to a point earlier in that some persons believe that just one vaccine is sufficient. It will not do it for you. The animal needs, like I said, the protocol is 3 vaccines at 1 month interval. So if you start within 3 months of your first vaccine, 2 months of your first vaccine, you should be able to have that animal have its full complement of vaccination, and the annual would be due 1 year after the last one, which is the 3rd vaccine. And this is the most important of the 3 vaccines, because this is the one that the animal is able to develop much more antibodies from. So the immune system is more mature at that stage, so you'll be able to get much more antibodies from that vaccination than your first 2. So it's critical that it's done at that time. And again, to please, some of you would want to take your furry friend out to visit friends, to the beach, to parks. Again, too, it's advisable that you don't do that. And I recommend that if you want to take a chance, that should not be no sooner than 3 after your food vaccine, at least 2 to 3 weeks after your food vaccine, you may want to take that chance. Yes. But again, too, please keep your furry friend within the confines at home. Don't expose him or her to conditions where they can contract the virus. You have dogs that are carriers at home, you would not know, or within the vicinity, and it's so easy for them to transmit the virus by sniffing at each other's faces. The anus, that's something that, you know, dogs like to do, go and sniff up each other. And by so doing, they can pick up the virus, the parvovirus, by those engaging in those practices, as easy as that. Yeah. Or you at home, I'm sure you must have heard that on the program. You may be in an area where it's very windy and dusty, and there may be some of these viruses in the area, because these are viruses, they can stay on the ground on dry surfaces for 9 years plus and be still very alive and active. So you may have some dust being blown onto your pants, onto your shoes, unknown to you, and you get home, and your puppy come to you sniffing, or on your tires, you're driving to your yard, you've driven over a mess that is infected, you would not know, and you have particles that you deposit into your yard, animal comes there, sniff, as easy as this, they can pick it up. Yeah, so again, to be on the P's and Q's, and again, it's your responsibility. Those persons who would be receiving for your friends for Christmas as gifts, to make sure that the gift that you have received has a certain level of immunity. At least the first vaccine has been given, and you should know or find out when the next one is due, so at least you can start taking on the responsibility of a parent of a furry friend, and to make sure that the level of protection is given to your furry friend, and not allowing he or she out there to be exposed to the virus or any one of those viruses. But the one that we are most concerned about is the parvovirus, and that is the one that is causing some serious havoc. The lepto to a certain extent, but the parvo, yes. So again, too, precaution better than cure. It is so much more cost effective in vaccinating the animal instead of trying to respond to a situation where the animal is infected with any one of those diseases that they are vaccinated against. Yeah. I would want to bring up a point in here too, that some persons have been calling and requesting rabies vaccines for their dogs. We do not rabies is not one of those diseases that we vaccinate for St. Lucia. We vaccinate an animal for rabies as a prerequisite for that animal meeting the conditions of entering into a country that requests that's part of the requirement of entry into that country. So if an animal is traveling to a rabies endemic country, or rabies, St. Lucia is rabies free, so it's not compulsory that they are not. We would make it compulsory animal is coming in here to be vaccinated, or certain countries, as part of the requirements for entry, they would want the animal to be vaccinated. And on that reason, we would vaccinate an animal that is traveling to another country where that is part of their requirement for entry. Yes, but other than that, it is not standard practice to vaccinate an animal for rabies. And the reason for this is the vaccine for rabies, you have some vaccines that carries live viruses or attenuated viruses and has the ability to cause disease. So you don't want to have animals with that propensity within your population, and that can be a risk of transmission. So for that purpose, it's not part of our protocol, so we don't, unless the animal is traveling. Okay, well, we started late. We've done our hour for the night, so it's come to the point where we need to say good night. Thank you for those of you who called into the program, and those of you who are just taking in the information. And again, too, I want to end on the note of, please, those of you who don't have charcoal at home, please try and get some into your first aid cabinet, your first aid kit. Get some charcoal tablets. It can be used for you, and also for your friends. If there is, you observe that there is some, the animal may have been exposed to some level of poisoning, so that would help to counteract. So your milk or your charcoal, okay? Make that part of your first aid kit. Again, good night. Thank you again for tuning in. Those of you who have missed the program, you can visit us on the DBS TV Facebook or the St. Lucia Veterinary Medical Center Facebook page. Or you can go to our webpage, veterinarymedicalcenter.com. And there's a link in there. The recordings are available. You could visit any one of them. And enough information there as well, too. Those of you who are avid animal lovers, enough information there that you could immerse yourself and be informed. Again, thank you for tuning in, and we will see you next Saturday, CDFL, same place, same time. Good night. Bosswear.
You're watching DBS.
Amira wants to sing at my wedding.